Here with our Chief of Staff, Dr. Dan Sucato, in honor of Scoliosis Awareness Month, and we're here to talk about Adolescent Idiopathic Scoliosis. So, welcome back.
Thanks, it's good to be back.
It's a week later.
It's a week later. It's our third week in a row. It's getting to be a regular thing and kind of fun.
We're excited. Okay, so let's jump in.
Okay.
What is AIS?
So AIS stands for, as you've already said, Adolescent Idiopathic Scoliosis, and it's, let's break it down. Adolescent, because you're older than 10, that's the definition. Idiopathic means we're not smart enough to tell you why you may have scoliosis, and then scoliosis. So adolescent idiopathic scoliosis. By far the most common type of scoliosis that we see affects otherwise healthy, normal adolescents. And it's typically after 10 years of age when they begin to go through their growth spurt. So they start out with a really small curve, and then with growth and their growth spurt, the curve generally wants to take off. And so we monitor that. It gets viewed by schools. It gets viewed by the pediatrician to sort of make sure that they don't get a curve that is so big that it's out of control and can't be treated appropriately.
So how is this different than some of the other scoliosis? You know, last week we talked about early onset. So does that sometimes do patients start with EOS and it goes into AIS or?
Yes, so great question. So the basic premise behind scoliosis is that, and how we judge whether it's going to get bigger, is number one, are the vertebrae normal? If the vertebrae are normal, then that's, and the child is otherwise healthy, normal, whether they're less than 10 or older than 10, that's idiopathic scoliosis. Early onset is that big term we talked about last week, where if they're less than 8, then they're an early onset scoliosis. They can be congenital, they can be neuromuscular, they can be syndromic, and they also can be idiopathic if everything else is normal. So it's a diagnosis of exclusion. If you exclude everything else, they're idiopathic. The challenge with the early onset is they have so much growth left. When they're older than 10, they have typically anywhere from 4 years of growth between 10 and 14 in girls, typically, and from 10 to 16 year, in boys. So their growth potential is less, therefore the risk for that curve to get bigger with time is also less. So that's the difference.
Okay. So then in terms of treatments, you know, we've talked about bracing and surgery. So how does that play into this condition?
So in adolescent idiopathic scoliosis, the first thing they do when they come, and we talked a little bit about this last week, is that they get a physical exam. They we really ask them a lot of important questions like, is the scoliosis painful? And in general, we don't think adolescent idiopathic scoliosis causes pain, but certainly many young adolescent patients, boys and girls, come in with low back pain, which is relatively common. And so we want to know that. But is it sort of atypical back pain? Because atypical back pain means pain that happens at nighttime when they're asleep. They're asleep, and all of a sudden they wake up with back pain. That's different than if you have back pain that sort of prevents you from going to sleep at night.
Right.
So as an example, those are really important questions, and there's several others. Then we do a good physical exam. We do the Adams-Ford-Bend test, where they sort of stand with their arms at their side. We from behind, we examine them, they bend forward, and we're looking for the rotational aspect. And we're going to show a couple pictures here.
Okay.
And then they will, if it looks like they have scoliosis, then we'll get an x-ray. And we'll look for a lot of things, and we'll show you some of those things on x-ray. So, based on their age, how much growth they have left, and based on their curve magnitude, how big is the curve, those two are the real big predictors for what we do in terms of treatment.
Okay.
So oftentimes in small curves, we just watch them. If you have a 20 degree curve and you're 13 years of age and you only have about a year of growth left, that patient doesn't need anything. A 20 degree curve is just going to do fine throughout the rest of their life, won't cause them any troubles, won't be any issues. If they have a 20 degree curve and they're 10 or 11, then we have to watch them closely. We may even start a brace at that point. So bracing is important for curves between 20 degrees, sometimes we wait until they're 25 degrees, but not beyond that, up till about 40 or 45 degrees, then we'll brace those patients. And the goal of bracing is to prevent the curve from getting any bigger.
Right.
So I can show you.
Yeah,
I'd like to see a typical.
Definitely.
So here's a young lady that presented to us at 10 years of age, and hopefully you can see this on x-ray. And so instead of her spine being perfectly straight, she has this curve to the right, the most common type of scoliosis we see. So when we look at the x-ray, the bones themselves, the vertebra are all normal, their shape is normal, but the contour of the spine is curved to the right, the most common type of scoliosis. Now this young girl was 10, almost 10 and a half. So there's some other information here that's important to us to say how much growth she has left. Typically girls at 10 are growing very fast. Mm-hmm. And so you could see this curve on her. We did an exam, you could see it. The x-rays clearly show a 35 or 36 degree curve, so that curve is going to get bigger with time, and so bracing is appropriate. And so all the braces are custom-made braces, so we're very, very fortunate here at this institution to have our own orthotics department, so everything is done in-house. Mm-hmm. Our orthotists are side-by-side with us in the clinic, and so when we see a young lady like this, we work with our orthotists and we say, you know, what type of brace do you think? Right. First of all, is a brace appropriate? The answer is yes. What type of brace?
And are there different types of braces and what are they?
Yes, so there's basically two main types of braces. There's the all day and nighttime brace.
Okay.
And then for certain curve patterns, there's the nighttime brace.
Okay.
And that's a specific indication that's been developed over the years through lots of study and research. Mm-hmm. The study that was done here by Don Kotz clearly demonstrated that thoracic lumbar curves, so curves that are primarily down in this mm-hmm. area, that are between 25 and 35 degrees can be effectively treated with a nighttime brace, which obviously in children's and families' lives is a much easier thing to do than
right.
the all-day and nighttime brace.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the nighttime, all-day and nighttime brace that you wear the vast majority of the time. And so
right.
we shoot for 18, 20 hours a day, which is challenging, but if parents sit down and go over a month schedule with their child and say, you know, on these days, you're going to get in at 20 hours a day. On this day, you have a big swim party, and you're just not going to wear
right.
it. You're going to wear 12 hours a day. Once in a while, that's okay. That works out fine. We don't want this to sort of run children's
right.
lives.
Well, because, you know, with these kids, they're young, and so
yep.
they want to be active and be playing around.
They
so
do.
With that, I know that we've done a lot of research with monitors inside
right.
of the brace.
Yes.
And so does that help with getting the kids to wear them more
yeah.
and be have parents be, you know, rooting for them.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, so those are studies that have been done here. Lori Carroll and her team and Don Borostik, who
mm-hmm.
now runs orthotics department, and Kevin Felton and a lot of other people have done some really nice work. If you put a temperature sensor in the brace, and Don Kotz started this work several years ago, if you put a temperature sensor in the brace, it pings the brace every 15 minutes and says, is the body temperature 98, is the temperature within the brace body temperature?
Right.
If it is, then the patient's wearing the brace.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have shown clearly that if you monitor children, that they are more likely to wear the brace. And so we monitor all of our children. We give them a report card. We say, here's what you're doing. You're either doing really well or there's opportunity for improvement. And most of the time, if you sit down and say, here are the days, you know, that you're not wearing it. Let's see
right.
if we can improve on that. And that's been very effective because the more they wear it, the more effective the brace is.
Right.
So this is a typical brace. As you can see, it's low profile. It goes under the clothes. This one was made for a young lady. You can see that she wanted the red,
very
white, and blue.
Patriotic.
Very patriotic
yes.
in this time of year. So she got the red, white, and blue. And it's low profile. We provide the t-shirts. Measure them for the brace. It takes about 3 or 4 weeks for our department to make the brace. They get a separate appointment to fit the brace.
Okay.
They're given the t-shirts. They're given all the little tricks to kind of get used to the brace. We give them a little bit of time to get used to the brace. And then they wear the brace until they're done growing. And so that works out really well. And
are there certain signs to knowing if it's too tight or if it doesn't fit right
yeah.
for parents to probably know?
Great question. So every time they come in, the orthotist sees them and visits with them, puts the brace on, sees if there's any pressure spots. Sometimes when they first get the brace, they get a little redness in certain spots, and so they have to change the trim lines
okay.
a little bit and contour the brace. So every time they come in, which is usually every 6 months or so,
okay.
sometimes every 3 months, depends on the scenario, then we reassess the brace. So that's a typical brace, goes under the clothes, very well tolerated. Usually, if they get used to wearing it right away, then they may do very well. So this young lady came in. We, on the visit after they're assigned the brace or prescribed the brace, they come back in generally 2 months after they've been prescribed the brace to give the orthotist a month to make the brace. They get an appointment with the orthotist, then they come back and see us a month after that, so 2 months from their initial prescription of the brace, to get an x-ray in the brace, because we want to see good correction in the brace. So the way the brace works is as you wear the brace, as you're growing, the curve is better in the brace, so that as you grow, the curve doesn't get any bigger.
Okay.
So we want to see on that first visit, is it a good brace? So here it is a good brace. We've gone from 36 down to 16 degrees. That's
wow.
really good correction.
Yeah, that's awesome.
You can see there's some rivets here that kind of tell you where the pads are within the brace.
Mm-hmm.
There's also the temperature sensor that's in the brace on this particular young lady. So this young lady was fantastic with the brace. And she wore the brace. She participated in athletics. She was a volleyball player.
That's nice.
Yep.
Love that sport.
Love that sport,
yeah.
Right? I knew you would. And so then after she wore the brace for 2 years, and 2.5 years, she was 10 and a half, she wore it till she was about 13. And then here she is at 16 years of age, so she's been out of the brace for 3 years. She has the same curve, we measured it actually at 34, so it's 36 when she first came to us at 10. Here she is in the x-ray in the brace, and then she's done growing, her spine isn't going to change. She's left with a 34 degree curve, she looks very good, doesn't bother her, will never bother her, and it's a treatment success.
So it is normal for it, the curve might bounce back a little bit.
The curve will always go
always.
Back. Yes, so
always.
As soon as they come
okay.
out of the brace, their curve will be back.
Okay.
Okay. When they're in the brace, they are corrected so that as they grow, the curve doesn't get any bigger.
Okay.
As soon as they come out of the brace, that's where they are. Now, on children who are growing really fast,
mm-hmm.
that wear the brace really, really well, 18
yeah.
to 20 hours a day, have we seen improvement that's permanent? The answer is yes. That's not very typical, though.
Mm-hmm.
But this, you wouldn't be able to tell this. You wouldn't see this on this young lady. It's not a functional issue. She does everything she wants to do. She has no back pain. And the long-term studies show that curves like this, long-term, don't get any bigger and really don't cause any issues at all.
That's good. And so she was, I mean, even with this brace on, you can't play sports. Or do you have to be limited?
Well, you can do certain activities
okay.
with the brace, but really to play volleyball,
mm-hmm.
you take the brace off.
Okay.
And you're able to do all activities. So they take the brace off, do their activities, and you have between 4 to 6 hours
yeah.
To sort of do those activities.
Okay.
You wear it in bed.
Okay.
You can't wear it to shower, swim. But we certainly want the kids to do
right.
those activities.
That's awesome. So yeah. then another treatment is surgery typical
yeah.
for this. So maybe get into that.
So surgery is typically for two scenarios. The biggest really is curves that we know are going to be progressive even if you're done growing. So scoliosis gets bigger in two ways. Scoliosis progression happens in two ways. One is if you're growing fast, or if the curve is so big after you're done growing, it just wants to get bigger into
mm-hmm.
adulthood. And so in general terms, that curve magnitude is 50 degrees. Remember, we measure scoliosis in degrees. The straight spine is 0 degrees. Anything above 10 degrees is true scoliosis. Above 50 degrees, curves just will get bigger even if you're done growing. So a 16-year-old, and the average increase per year is roughly 1 degree per year. So
okay.
if you have a 15-year-old child who's done growing, or a 16-year-old child who's done growing, has a 55-degree curve, 20 years later they're going to have a 75-degree curve and they're still very young. So
right.
that's the indication for surgery. And so generally we try obviously to avoid surgery with bracing,
right.
early detection, so happening in schools, it happens in schools, happens in the pediatrician's office, so those are really important. But there are many times
right.
where surgery is appropriate. So we've come a long, long way from surgery,
right.
we've come a long, long way with surgery over the years. The goals of surgery are twofold. One is to prevent the curve from getting any bigger,
mm-hmm.
and the second is to correct the curve a certain amount. And we're very successful in yet obtaining really good correction today safely, and that's the most important part.
Right.
Safety, safety, safety. We do a lot of things here at this institution that have made surgery safe. We continue to study how to make surgery safe. And the safety aspects are avoiding issues like infection.
Right.
And we have a performance improvement committee.
Mm-hmm.
We have a special task force that's led by Amy McIntosh. And Carrie Wilder, who's in performance improvement, to really decrease that
right.
infection rate to the goal would be zero.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've made huge strides in doing that. And it's antibox before, it's traffic in the operating room, all sorts. There was a 3-tier program
right.
that really focused in on really challenging spines. So that's important. The most important thing, and the thing we worry about the most, is neurologic issues. Anytime you're operating on the spine, spinal
mm-hmm.
cord issues, neurologic issues can happen. And so we have state-of-the-art spinal cord monitoring equipment in the operating room with a spinal cord monitoring team in the operating room who their whole job is to watch the spinal cord monitoring and to make sure that the spinal cord function is normal throughout surgery. And those are all in-house people. We don't outsource that to anybody. Very few institutions do that. And so we have the same team in the operating room. Some of us surgeons actually look at the data also, and that makes it very safe. So for idiopathic scoliosis, we've just completed a 20-year study of our spinal cord monitoring over the last 20 years. And the incidence of spinal cord changes that happen in the monitoring waves that we're looking at in the operating room is 2%. So 2 out of 100. And of those 2%, nobody woke up with any permanent neurologic problems. So it's a great track record. It's been very safe. And the surgery correction is very effective, which I can show you if you want.
Yeah, definitely.
So here's a young boy. This is a very typical curve, double curve. Again, right thoracic curve. His curve magnitude measured 57. This curve measured 58. He has a right thoracic curve and a left lumbar curve. This actually was done 15 years ago, this surgery. And so we got nice correction. You can see the way we obtain correction is we attach to the spine some anchor points, and today those are screws. So you can see the screws. This is the x-ray looking from the side. This is the x-ray looking from the back. So the same x-ray here is there. And then we attach to those anchor points two rods, and they're used to correct the spine and hold it in that corrected position until the spine fuses. And that's the downside of surgery, is fusion. So these segments of the spine become essentially one bone. The nice thing is here, we stopped at L3, so this young man had three motion segments left, and he went back and did everything he wanted to do. So this is a very typical surgery. Sometimes we see young folks who come in with very large curves, and this is a young lady that came with a 115-degree curve. That's a much bigger curve than is typical, but fortunately here we're able to take care of the very straightforward to the very complex. And so this young lady had the same type of surgery, and you can see the difference in her x-ray from here to here. And so here her spine looks very good. And probably more important than this x-ray in terms of the long-term health of your spine is this. We like to see thoracic kyphosis and lumbar lordosis. Overall, it looks really good. And this is what this young lady looks like. Here she is before surgery, and here she is after surgery, and she did very, very well. So that gives you a little glimpse of what surgery is all about.
Wow. Okay. So I think we have a few questions from some of our followers that we kind of wanted to touch base about. One says, my daughter is 15 and has a 48-degree curve. If it doesn't progress, will she be okay to live her life with the curve?
Yeah, that's a great question. So that question is sort of in the gray zone. So she's 48. I told you that above 50 or above, you know, we generally see curves get bigger into adulthood. So each patient really needs to be evaluated. What is that? How does that 48-degree curve look on her? What's her perception of how she feels? If she's happy with how she looks, if she doesn't have a body shift to the right or to the left, and has a nice balanced coronal plane, meaning looking at her from the side and from the front, then that 48-degree curve won't cause her any trouble now, and certainly won't cause her any trouble in the future, as long as it doesn't progress rapidly. Right. And that would be somebody that you would want to watch and maybe get an x-ray every 5 to 10 years.
Okay.
So the short answer, that was a long answer, the short answer is that she should be great. So as she gets older, childbearing, having a family, no issues. You know, are you more likely to have a little bit more back pain in adulthood than we all have if you have a little scoliosis? The answer is absolutely, but it's small and shouldn't run their life in any way.
Very good. Okay, I think we have time for one more question. And this parent asks, can a child that has had a spinal fusion have an MRI?
The answer is yes. So, and we do that all the time. And so the implants today are made of titanium, and they're also made of cobalt chrome, which are, you know, definitely magnetic, but they're securely fixed to the spine. And so obtaining an MRI is very, very safe. No issues. We do it all the time. Because there's metal there, sometimes the visualization of things adjacent to where the metal is somewhat challenging. But the radiology teams are getting much more sophisticated in getting good MRIs and good quality MRIs that they can see. So yeah, it's not a problem.
Very good. Well, that's some really good information for this week, and we appreciate you coming again.
Well, thanks. It's been fun.
So please continue to watch. Leave any of your comments. We will make sure to answer them as they come in. So we will see you next week.